to you from our Lord Jesus Christ. Hi. What an adorable little boy. On behalf of Faye and the family, I want to welcome you here this morning in the name of Jesus. We, as you, some of you have already heard me pray, are here to honor the memory of a beloved friend and husband and dad, grandfather, great-grandfather. We're here to honor his memory. And what I know about Merv, he would also want the honor directed to his Savior, Jesus Christ. One of the lasting memories I will have of the man was one of the last visits that I had with him, where while lying on his bed in his living room, I sat beside him and held his hand and had the Bible open to Ephesians 1. And it's been a long time since I had somebody so glued to me in the reading of the word, and with every phrase that I read in Ephesians 1, his hand gripped tighter and tighter. And at every phrase, I would look him right in the eye as both of us began to cry. And I said to him, Merv, I said, do you believe that? And without hesitation, without equivocation, every phrase in Ephesians 1 was a hearty yes. Now, if you're not familiar with Ephesians 1, let me encourage you to have at least a brief look at it, because every phrase in Ephesians 1 is astounding. And for him, Okay, good. We're back. Where was I? We're grateful that you're here. And Faye and the family are grateful for you to be here as well. We have a fairly short itinerary. I hope you have a handout. They look like this. I do want to make this real clear, real quickly. This picture can be blamed on Faye, because when I visited with her last week, she had taken this down and she literally said to me, this is my favorite. And I said, can we put that on the front of the bulletin? And she said, sure. And then I got the prune story, because I've handed this out and people have looked at it and seen the prunes and looked at me like, are you okay? And I said, well, I'll explain that. I said, but it's not my fault, but it is a great picture, isn't it? It's a wonderful picture, and I can completely understand how it can be one of your favorites. Even the gentleman at Staples last night wanted to know what was with the prunes. And I said to him, it's none of your business. Would you pray with me? And then we will read together one of Merv's favorite passages. We were going to assign a reader to it, and then I thought, you know what, why don't we all say it together? And we'll do that. The words will be on the overhead in just a moment. Our Father, we give you thanks and praise for this day. We thank you for bringing us together. I thank you for the strength that you've provided to dear Faye and to her family. Father, it has been a blessing to be around them and to work with them. Thank you for the ministry of the Hans that has been so important these last couple of weeks as well. Thank you that Dick is in good health and is able to speak this day. We look forward to hearing what you have to say through him. Thank you for the other participants as well, for Sheila's words that will be read by Carol, and Zach, beloved grandson, who will be up in a few minutes to read as well. We want to honor you today, Father. May the words of our mouths and the meditations of our hearts be pleasing in your sight, O God. You are our rock and our redeemer. And we look to you now for guidance and for direction and for comfort, not only in this moment, but in the days to come as well. And we ask it humbly in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let me invite you to stand, if you would, and we'll together read John 14, 1-6, a very well-known passage. And then please remain standing. We'll sing one of the great hymns of the faith. A friend of mine calls it the national anthem of the Christian church, Amazing Grace. But first, let's together read John 14, 1-6. Do not let your heart be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many dwelling places. If it were not so, I would have told you, for I go to prepare a place for you. If I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How do we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. Amen. That's good reading. That's good reading. Together now, let's sing Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound. Please be seated. Amen. Please forgive me for failing to welcome our online viewers. We're glad that you're able to be with us this day, especially those of you who are watching us from Canada, our good neighbors in the north. God bless you and welcome to the memorial service for Merv Vino. As you can see on the overhead, the words of Sheila Scully, Merv's daughter, eulogizing her dad will be read now by dear friend of the family, Carol LeBrie.
Good morning. These words by Sheila and reading them warmed my heart, for they are truly Merv. Merv had a plaque that said any man can be a father, but it takes someone special to be daddy. It hung over his bed for a long time. Truer words were never spoken. Mervin was a very special man. He was a loving husband to Faye for 61 years and daddy to his girls, later their husbands, and papa and grampy to his grandchildren and great-grandchild. He worked hard, but always had time for family and friends. He was a man of few words, but as a friend recently said, he could tell a story getting to the end eventually. A trait he passed to several of his family. He loved to renovate homes, rebuild and paint cars, play guitar, and play with his grandchildren. He could often be found on the floor surrounded by toys. Mervin was born in a little house that had once been a shoe cobbler's shop in New Germany, Nova Scotia. He was the second of nine children. He worked alongside his father in numerous local businesses, using his mechanical side to build bikes out of baby carriages and a car for his brother. He also worked for George, Faye's father, where he met Faye as a teenager. He chummed around with her and her sister Sherry, and later Sherry's husband Barry. Merv married Faye on October 6, 1962. Merv moved to the U.S. shortly after living in Lynn and after a brief return to Nova Scotia. They again returned to the U.S. and settled in Saugus. Mervin turned a small four-room cottage into an 11-room home with a two-car garage, workshop underneath where his family grew, children grew, grandchildren played, and many friends and family were welcomed. He could often be found playing guitar with his wife and neighbors or under the hood of a car, as we all well know. This meant his friends learned to swing a hammer, spread plaster, crawl around rooftops, carry buckets of rock because the house was on ledge, mow lawns all while wearing their dresses or helping mom. He taught his girls to chuck and change oil in a car, change a tire if necessary, and how to jump start a car. He loved to work on cars or anything with wheels and a motor. He would buy them, fix them, and then sell them. He would rebuild and fix them for family, including daughters, brothers, father-in-law, and brother-in-law. Mervin was an automotive mechanic at American Airlines in Boston for 25 years before his retirement in 1996. At American Airlines, he made several lifelong friends. He was a valued employee, even saving a co-worker's arm, earning a trip anywhere in the world American Airlines flew. He and Faye went to Hawaii. Mervin's family had lots of American Airlines swag. They had typical airline wigs, but there was also discontinued silverware blankets and other trinkets. When Merv retired, he went to work at Joanne's Fabric for 5 years. He also built fine furniture, the last large piece being a bookcase for Sheila's daughter, Jennifer, to hold what was at the time a large book collection. It is still in use today, but no longer for books. Merv worked in the homes of his children and friends, and even on this very church. Merv always had something in line to keep him busy when the current project ended, more often than not, more than one project at a time. After selling the Saugus home and moving to Peabody, he would renovate that house, too, adding a two-car garage and a workshop, of course, to that home, too. He could fix and construct anything, making sure everything was finished to precision. In 2005, he was baptized, became a member and deacon of Austin Square Baptist Church, where he continued to make many more lifelong friends. He was treasured by all who knew him. He will be greatly missed. He taught the girls to be strong, independent women, and was a wonderful example of what a daddy could be. The girls would like to say thank you. This morning, as I was going over this and thinking about this, I thought about the last time that I spent time with Merv and Faye, and I was with Dick and Dell. And at the very end of our visit, we stopped to have prayer. And at the very end of the prayer, Merv put his hand up and said he wanted to say something. So we all stopped, and he started by saying, "May the Lord bless you." And then he kind of got hung up and couldn't bring up the rest of what he wanted to say. And I said, "And keep you," and he smiled. And together we said, "Make his eyes to shine upon you and give you peace." And I'm sure he would say that to every one of you.
Thank you, Sheila. I can completely understand now how that would have been a little bit of a challenge for you. Yeah. Thank you, Carol. Such an honor to the family. God bless you. Thank you so much. In putting the program together, Faye and family wanted at least a brief moment of time for the floor to open, for you to share where you are, a memory, or a favorite thought or a word of encouragement to the family about Merv. Brian Torreira is a co-chair together with Ken Jollimore, as well as Dale Lepick, our deacons, a board of which Merv was a part. Brian's got the microphone in his hand, and he'll be glad to come around to any of you who just simply slip your hand in the air so that you can be recognized and you can share in the hearing of all some encouragement you might want to say. As you're thinking about what you might want to say, I do want to briefly draw your attention to the back page of your bulletin so that you're aware of all of the family members that are there. That's taken from the Cuff McGinn website obituary. But there's also an opportunity for you, in addition to or in lieu of flowers, to make a contribution to the American Parkinson's Disease Association in Merv's honor. Okay, I just wanted to be sure that was highlighted for you and you were aware of that option as a way of encouraging the family as well. Anybody have a word that they would like to share? Family or otherwise? Don't feel obligated, but please also, it takes that first person before anybody else will talk. So somebody, feel free to be first, please. Yes.
And Merv was one of the people that renovated my house. And we had a porch, and then he transformed it into the kid part of the kitchen. So in the meantime, I had all my stuff that was on the porch in the kitchen. And every time he did something, at the end of the day, he would pick things up and put things down. So it's a running joke that we pick things up and we put things down, and we pick things up and put things down.
Someone else. Now that Dell has been so gracious to break the ice for us. Someone else, an encouraging word to the family, please.
While some of you were warming up, as Pastor Mark said, my name is Brian. I had the privilege of being on the deacon board with the move here. And what I'm going to say is not surprising in that Merv was a large man, but a very humble and soft-spoken man. And hearing about all the renovations and so forth around your homes and so forth, Merv's legacy, so to speak, although I know he wouldn't think of those terms around the church here, he kind of left his mark all over the church because, similar to your homes, he did quite a bit of work and renovations here. Right above my head, when we had our first projector put in, Merv built the beam there and the brackets for it, put the projector in and ran up and down the ladder like a 15-year-old, renovated the bathrooms, put windows in the doors to the classrooms, all the stuff that none of us could figure out how to do. So I know he just passed recently, but he's been missed here for a long time, and I can honestly tell you that his shoes here have not been filled yet in what he used to do here, so we miss him.
Brian said a lot of what I wanted to say. Merv, to me, was a gentle giant who just served and just loved everyone, and he is sorely missed.
A word of testimony, a word of encouragement.
A very forgiving man.
First.
I'm Carol Richardson, and I've known the family for a good many years. Loved them, had the girls, just enjoyed them, period. But my son had borrowed a car from one of the girls. I won't say who, but he totaled it. Merv never, ever was angry. He said, "Don't worry, I'll fix it," and so he did.
You have to be ready for almost any kind of testimony when you do this. A wrecked car. God bless. Anyone else? Going once. Going twice. Thank you, Brian. Thank you so much. Appreciate that encouragement, that lighthearted chuckle along the way. It's good to know the man. Let me invite you to stand with me again, and we'll sing another great hymn of the song of the church, "Great is Thy Faithfulness."
Thank you. You may be seated. Indeed, its faithfulness is great. Beloved grandson, Zachary Powers, will come forward now and read for us Matthew 20, 1-16, a text which ASBC Elder Dick Hahn will come forward and share a brief devotional for your encouragement in the honor of Merv. Zach?
Yep. Matthew 20, verses 1-16. For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. When he came and agreed with the laborers for a denarius for the day, he sent them into the vineyard. And when he came out at about the third hour, he saw the other standing idle in the marketplace. And to those he said, also go into the vineyard, and whatever is right I will give you. And so they went. Again he went out around the sixth and the ninth hour and did the same thing. About the 11th hour, he went out and found others standing around, and he said unto them, why have you been standing idle all day long? They said to him, because no one hired us. He said to them, you go into the vineyard too. When the evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his foreman, call the laborers and pay them their wages, beginning with the last group to the first. When those hired about the 11th hour came, each one received a denarius. When those hired first came, they thought, why would they receive more? Excuse me. They thought that they would receive more, but each of them also received a denarius. When they received it, they grumbled at the landowner, saying, these last men have worked only an hour, and you have made them equal to us, which have borne the burden and scorching heat of the day. But he answered to them and said, friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for a denarius? Take what is yours and go, for I wish to get the last man the same as you. Is it not lawful for me to do what I wish with what is my own? Or is your eye envious because I am generous? So shall the last be first and the first be last. Thank you.
Please, is someone else getting up here speaking? A few years ago, I had a friend that I saw. She owned a campground that we rented a cabin from, and heard that her mother had died. So I did the usual sorry for your loss type of line. And this is the first and only time usually people don't have a comeback. And, you know, they just say, thank you very much, whatever, I'll move on. And she said, wow, you know what that means. I said, no. And she said, where next? It took me a while. It just threw me. I didn't expect that response. Thought about that. Sure enough, within a year, she had passed away as well. She was ready. She was correct. You and I, we're next. When you come to something like this, and you think of your loved one, and a lot of things go into your mind. I mean, some of you are probably very numb. You're spent. You're exhausted. You just want to get this out of the way. And if you're going to be very honest, I mean, you just want to move on. You've done a lot of work preparing for this and taking care of him during these past several weeks, months. Did what you could, did what was best. And so funerals are awkward. They're uncomfortable. They're just like something you'd rather not be at, honestly. And yet, I want to bring you some measure of comfort, some measure of hope, if I can, with this thing I want to share with you from this passage, something that Merv knew very well as well. First of all, Sheila, you did a great job filling in for what we don't know, what we didn't know about Merv. And there's still things we don't know about Merv. And there's still things, I mean, that picture and your bullet with the prunes, there's a story there. You can ask her later. That's the vino humor. That's the sense of humor they got. He had a great sense of humor, even when he was kind of being strict of his dignity, being in a bed. And I go visit him, and I said, "Well, you know, at the end, great to see you," and he says, "Good to be seen." And it was a great comeback because it made me appreciate that. Yeah, it is great to be seen. You know, you do more than you think when you visit someone and their need like that. And there were times when I would see him and get the kind of rapport with him. I really got to know him in the past 10 years more than ever, partly because he and Faye practically lived at our place. I mean, I'd come home from work and he'd still be there working. They were a real team. Whenever they worked on something. And he was a handyman, ultimate handyman. Sometimes he punted, sometimes he learned as he went. I mean, one time we put the solar light in, and the light that would have a motion detector, and it didn't work, and we realized we put it in upside down, so we put it in the right way. But I mean, you got it down good. I'm not a handyman. I learned from him that it's okay to mess up. You learn from it, and he just plodded along. He and I would be under my trailer. Anyone been in a trailer? They're not far above the ground, and we'd be just stuck under there, and I'd be handing him the screws while he used the power screwdriver, and we'd do it for hours, just closing in the bottom of the trailer. So we were in close quarters. We got to know each other pretty well. And there was one more recent thing I want to share with you. When you're getting older, you get more limitations, and your independence is gradually being stripped away, and you're going to grab whatever you can to make decisions that you can make decisions. Everybody else is making them for you, and you'd rather not have that being done. And so there was one time, maybe a couple of weeks ago, Faye and Ann went to do some errands. And I went to visit to watch him. I figured this would be piece of cake. You know, we'll just, because he was in and out of clear thinking. And he always talked very faintly, and it's sometimes hard for me to hear him. So he came around, and he asked me to get the kitchen chair. I said, "Maybe he's hallucinating, you know, maybe he's as what?" And he's, "Bring the chair over here." He's in the hospital bed in the living room. He's not able to get up. So he needs the chair over to him. And all right, I said, "Okay, you want me to get the kitchen chair and bring it over?" He's, "Yes." And so I put the chair over there. He's now lifted up and put it over me. So what kind of thing is he doing here? I said, "What?" And he's, just put it over me. And he said, and so he's fiddling around with the bottom of the chair, making sure it functions right, you know, making sure it's all set. And I'm thinking, I said, why do you want me to do that? He's, because I said so. And really clear daddy language. It's like, whoa, last time I heard that stern voice is my own dad years ago. I was like, whoa. And then we both laugh. I said, it's a good thing you got me in a good mood, Murph. You know, because I put the chin. And what he was doing was wanting to be useful to the very end. Very. He handled that with grace under pressure. He handled that well. Being able to, for a handyman, it's tough. But someone not being able to use their hands like he used to. But even to that end, I mean, just 3 weeks ago, he tried, even with a kitchen chair. So I saw that part of him that was there. I mean, he's not a plaster saint. He's a real person. He had real aggravations, but he had real needs. He wanted to be useful in some way. And everybody else was doing their best and doing a good job to keep him home as long as they did. So, well, I learned some things during those times when I went to Vino's house. The times on the farm and how they would be seen on the tractor in a bathing suit, and he kind of like got smitten by her, and they eventually got married young, and they came to America, and they the girls came around and they had children, and they came to this church, and they made some really good close friends here. I call it the Saucus crowd. You know, Carol LaBrie, Carol Richardson, Stephanie, the PSC's fellow Canadians, they really had a real connection there. So there was a great friendship that they had here. So he would come to this church for years. He did all those church things. He did church. He learned to do church well. He fit in pretty well. And I'd see him coming in just about every Sunday. And he's more regular than a church member. I mean, he's here. He's putting the kids through Sunday school and youth group and VBS and all that that most parents would do. He's very supportive of their upbringing here. But somewhere along the line, he didn't seem to get it. But I'll let him speak in his own words. All right. And then we'll get into the scripture and we'll move on. This is his words. He gave a testimony when he was baptized up here. He says, I attended Sunday school when I was a child and went to an Anglican church and got married in a Baptist church with a. But as he grew up, he felt that being honest and hardworking was enough. And he was honest. And he was hardworking. He's got quite a legacy there. And he attended Austin Square for the first 30 years, off and on. In recent years, I felt my heart changing toward the things of the Lord. When I found out I had cancer, I got the why me's and tried pushing my burdens onto my neighbors, my friends, my family. He couldn't handle it well. I didn't cope very well, he says. After a lot of praying and feeling the love of church members, I decided that what I was doing wasn't enough anymore. I could feel Jesus working in my heart like a fire out of control. I had always thought you had to be well-versed in the Bible to become a Christian. You had to do all the church things. At first, I talked to my friend Brian Piercy, and later to Pastor Steve, which led to my realizing that I'm a sinner needing forgiveness for my sins, which I asked for and received. In spite of my great fear of water, I followed God's direction and was baptized in July. He wanted to join this church and support it and continue to learn and grow in the faith and to glorify God. That's in his words. And then when I called Pastor Steve, and he just almost word for word corroborated in his memory what Merv had to say. When he was came down with a cancer. He was really shaken. And he had good friends that steered him in the right direction, put him on the path of seeking the Lord out. And he kept coming here. He didn't get bitter or walk away. He kept sitting here. And the pastor Steve said, one day when he was sitting here and he heard a sermon, which is one of the means of grace that God uses, and then it clicked. It just it made sense. It all fit together. He understood finally. And that's when he went to be baptized, terrified of water. But he pushed through and he went ahead and got baptized. So since then, as has been said by Brian and others, he was pretty involved in here, doing his work and serving in people's homes and in this building, using his skills as a handyman and all those things. So I praise God for his testimony there, and it still speaks. It still speaks. Because now we have hope with him. I've been to funerals where you don't have that hope. We have that hope with him. We know he's not those ashes. He's not here. He's gone. He's with the Lord. He's where we want to be. He is where he wanted to be. And more than, towards the end, he wanted to go home, which was Nova Scotia. Almost heaven. You know, Canadians call it God's country. And I agree. I've been up there. Beautiful country. But it's nothing compared to heaven. And that's where he is. And that's the comfort I want to give you, even in this passage here. Because he is like that 11th hour servant. He came later in life, but he came. And that's our hope and our challenge, because we're next. Are we ready? It doesn't have to be the 11th hour for you. You can be younger or you can be older, but this is the right time to consider your standing before God, even as he did. Even though he did church well, he did all those church things, he went to church, he attended, he didn't get it. He didn't get it until it hit home. And finally it made sense. The word of God became clear to him. So just look at here in this passage here, in Matthew chapter 20, and that parable. Jesus told parables to bring about an eternal truth. And he's bringing out a truth here to his listeners because they needed to understand some things about the kingdom of heaven. So he starts out with, many of the times in Matthew, the kingdom of heaven is like. And in this parable, it speaks of the grace of God. It's all of grace. And this is the whole crux of the whole thing. We're so used to works, doing things right, getting paid for what we did right. And he kind of turns everything upside down. By the time you see the end of the parable, you see he's really thrown a monkey wrench in their understanding of how to do things right. So he tells this parable to explain this truth about the kingdom of heaven. He tells the story of a landowner. And the landowner hires laborers for his vineyard. And he goes to that marketplace for about five times, different hours of the day, through the heat of the day, from the morning to further on to the end of the day. And he goes to those five times. And he gives them, as promised, a day's wage, a denarii, which is what you would get paid for the day, the amount you would get for the day. And people still do that today. People go to Home Depot and they'll hire guys on the spot and they'll have them to do some work at home. They still do those type of things now. They go to a marketplace here and they wait for employment of some sort, some means of making a living, even for the day. So at the end of the day, he calls them all together and he does the opposite of what's expected of them. He pays the last first. He calls the last ones first. Usually you would have got the first workers who already started at the beginning of the day and paid that denarii as was promised. By the way, all of these workers got the same pay. They all got the denarii. He wasn't cheap. He didn't defraud them. He didn't watch the imagery of this landowner. The landowner is honorable. He's gracious. He's generous. He is more than what is expected of those who work later in the day. He gives them all the same pay. You'll see the activity of that landowner. He goes into the vineyard 5 times. He brings people to the vineyard from the marketplace. He goes and seeks them out, and he brings them back 5 times, even through the heat of the day himself. So he gives to all who work that day what was promised. He made a promise. He said, I will give you this. And he did follow through. He gave them the denarii. Their objection was, and this is what comes out at the end of the parable, was, this isn't fair. This is not right. This isn't just. Why should those people who only work for the last hour of the day get the same pay as we did when we worked through the whole day, through the heat of the day? And his answer was, don't I have the right to give what is mine and as he wished? He did not defraud them in any way. He gave them that. Now, I want to tell you what these things mean very briefly. The landowner is a boss. He gives what he wishes. The landowner is God the Father. The vineyard is the kingdom itself. He calls people into his kingdom. Different times of the day. The foreman, you see it very tucked away in there. I think it's verse 8. An evening came. The owner of the vineyard said to his foreman, call the laborers and pay them their wages, beginning with the last group to the first. Pay them their wages. Tells the foreman to do that. The foreman is Jesus. He paid. He paid what was required for them to enter into the kingdom of heaven. Even the ones that came late in life, he paid just as much with his life for that entrance into the kingdom of heaven. So we see that the denarii is eternal life. He gave them eternal life. So that's the essence of this. He's speaking to the disciples. He's speaking to the public who had a whole different set of standards. And he's showing the new standards, the new way of the kingdom of heaven, where he says the first shall be last and last shall be first. So we see those things. Those laborers are those who have come to believe. So when I thought of Merv and his 60s, I believe, maybe, coming around after all these years, and then he is ahead of me even. I came into the kingdom when I was in my teens, yet he gets the same reward I will get because of the grace of God. Even though I've worked many years and served many years my master, he served the same master, and he gets the same reward because of the one who paid for it. Not me, not him, but Christ. And so that offer was given. It's no longer how long you serve, it's the one you serve. And it's all of grace from the beginning to the end in this passage as you see it. It's kind of like the thief on the cross. He didn't have time to become a church member or be baptized or do any of those things. He just had to turn to Christ on the other cross and confess in his belief. And Christ said, this day you will be with me in paradise. At the same time, you have young Timothy, who was a leader in the church, who spent his lifetime serving the Lord along with Paul and Titus and others. But that thief gets the same reward as young Titus or young Timothy would get. So he got that same promise too. So this is the offer to you. You being next, you're next. And I am next. Are we ready? Are we in that vineyard? Are we going to be appreciating the boss who has given all things liberally and freely and graciously? Can we rejoice with someone like that, like Merv? Yes, I can. because even though he's gone, we're going to see him again. I can see him again. So to be absent from the body is present with the Lord, as Scripture says. So it will be the same for us. We have that hope, and that's the difference. Yes, we're going to grieve, and there's going to be different ways we're going to be grieving. We're going to be probably very angry today or tomorrow or the next day as things start sinking in, and you're going to miss him sorely. And you're going to always have the what ifs. If I had done this, or that'll always come your way. But always keep your focus on the boss, as I would say, the owner, the master, the one we serve. And know he is taking care of it all. I know there's a lot of plans into this funeral and ordering flowers and things. Jesus planned it all as far as making sure he had that mansion. I've gone to prepare a mansion for you. They're not. I am with you. So he has given those promises. He's paid it all. And that offers to you too, to consider yourselves in that kingdom, whatever time of the day God is going to lead you and call you. So with that, that's what I have to offer for a message for you this morning, is a message of hope, I think. It was his hope, as he expressed it in his testimony. And he did show it by serving to the best of his ability when he could. Why don't we just have a word of prayer? Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can come before you with that assurance that you have been so gracious, knowing the ways we walk, the things, the intents and the thoughts of our hearts, even now as we sit. Nothing can be hid from you. And yet you love us with an everlasting love. You love us with the same love that you, with which you love your son, Jesus. And so we thank you for the height and the depth and the breadth of your love as you've revealed it to us. And then some in the future, may you do that for those here, that you may, in your way, and the only way you can, give them the comfort they need and that assurance, as Merv has expressed. So we can rejoice as we do the celebration of his life, knowing that life has gone on. And we thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen. Let me introduce the song.
Thank you, Dick. Another one of our elders, Michael DeAngelis, is the one who helped put this bulletin together and choosing the songs and getting slides and the technology ready for us. Mark Melanson and a second Zachary, Zachary DeAngelis, are making the technology work for us today, including the live stream that is going to, did you say the New Jerusalem, Nova Scotia? Oh, it wasn't a New Jerusalem, the homeland. Is that what you call it? The homeland. Nova Scotia. I love Faye's accent that would be picked up every once in a while. This can be summarized in a very simple way. This word, this encouraging word that Dick has brought, and it's because he lives. So let's stand together. We'll sing this closing song with one another, and then Deacon Brian Torreira will come forward, and he will read our benediction. Thank you. reflection from the Gospel according to John.
Hear now the words of the Lord. Therefore, you too have grief now, but I will see you again, and your heart will rejoice, and no one is going to take your joy away from you. These things I have spoken to you, so that in me you may have peace. In the world you have tribulation, but take courage. I have overcome the world,
Amen.
Saith the Lord.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Brian. Thank you. You may be seated. At this time, the service is concluded. I would invite the family back up front, and those of you who would like to pay one last respect to do that if you have to leave. Otherwise, we will wait on our funeral director to come and give us further directions and to guide us to the cemetery for the graveside encouragement and burial, to which you are all invited. Okay, so please, if you would, please greet the family if you have to depart. Otherwise, we'll have a few minutes until the funeral director shows up, and then we'll make our way to Puritan Lawn Cemetery immediately following. Thank you so much for your kind participation in being here today as an encouragement to the family. God bless you.